Nighttime on Still Waters. This is NB506812, narrowcasting into the night from somewhere on Britain's waterways. First of November, Wednesday. November is born brave this morning. The dark water is alive with movement and a scatter of light. The walk from the boat to car is under a starfield and a bold moon. The moon hangs low in the east, whispering in the ears of Gemini the twins. But now the rain is beginning to sweep in from the south. This is the narrowboat Erica, narrow casting into a wet November night. To you, wherever you are. Thank you so much for coming on such a filthy night as this. So come inside and get dry by the fire. The kettle's boiled and there's a hot drink waiting for you. So let's slide close the hatches and lock the weather outside. I'm so glad that you could make it. Welcome aboard. Today, big banks of clouds have piled up, dark and growling from the south. The sun flitting between them, warming and welcome. And even though the teasel heads have been stripped bare, the goldfinches continue to dazzle the trees and hedgerows in rumbustious pantomimes of chirping movement. We've had another storm this week. The barometer fell in an almost all-time low. I read that at one point the barometric pressure was around 955 to the west of Cornwall, which is really low. However, we got off fairly lightly here, with a bit of blustery wind and some rain, but nothing like the conditions further south. And the water level in the canal is almost back to normal, despite having more rain. But the water remains soupy and almost bluish green from churned up sediment and runoff. In places, the surface has the appearance of solidity, forming a carpet mosaic of fallen leaves, green, brown and yellows. It looks too thick to move, yet it takes just one small moorhen to strike out across the canal for it to be transformed into shimmering water once more. But the fields remain saturated and in places waterlogged, dips and hollows filled with leaden troughs of quicksilver. Maggie picks her way with care, keeping to the grass ridges. She does not like having her paws wet or muddy. And the fiery colours of autumn spread down the towpath, although often somewhat muted by mists or veils of rain. But the deep crimsons and vermilions of hip and haw still richly blaze. Hawberries in particular are in great profusion, and I've been reading that even birds are not that keen on them. I don't quite understand why. And the ducks remain highly active. A lot of them have pairing off, but they're still remaining in fairly large groups. And from time to time, they will take to the air, wheeling around almost as soon as they're airborne, around about 20 to 30 feet above the ground. Splitting and rejoining, they circle before again peeling away, often in pairs or threes, and setting off in different directions. There's something very deliberate about the way ducks fly. The other evening, the cows had come down to the canal side near the fallen hawthorn, and most were grazing, but one, chin over the fence, was statue still, watching a small group of ducks splash and bathe. She stood there for maybe 4 minutes, perhaps more, and even when the rest of the herd were beginning to move away. What was she seeing in this little cameo of duck life? What was she thinking? How did she make sense of this movement, the pearls of water splash, the companionable chuck and quack vocalizations of the ducks? It was clearly them that she was watching. But how did she experience it? Were there too the hints of joy and sense of commonality that I too felt? Thank you to Sim and Zeno over on Mastodon. It was lovely to hear from you. And thank you, Zeno, for such lovely words. I was really struck by them. Thank you. And hello to our good friend MJ. And I think we're also sharing a similar autumn to you. And hi to Mark and Trish. And I'm so pleased that you enjoyed your cruise and that the weather didn't spoil things too much. And it was lovely to hear from you, Arabella. Thank you so much for your kind words. And I absolutely love that rendering of dragon's breath. And no doubt I'm going to be using it in the future. It was also great to hear from you, Margaret, and that fascinating account of your local band of mad, bad crows and the sparrowhawk. I hadn't heard of sparrowhawks killing a magpie, but as you say, when I looked them up, the female, which is larger and stronger than the male, apparently is more than capable of doing it. So thank you. I learned something new from that. And with the victim being a fellow corvid, I'm not at all surprised that the crows took great exception to it. And probably that sparrowhawk was very wise in moving off. And Lee also got in contact with me about her favourite childhood book, which seems to share a very similar theme to Brendan Chase. My Side of the Mountain. It sounds great. I do love that sound of its ending. The Brendan Chase ending always struck me, even as a child, as rather poignant and almost a little bit sad. I now wish that it ended in a little bit more like the way in which it does in My Side of the Mountain. So thank you. And thank you so much for all the ways in which you support this podcast. And a special hello and thank you to our lock wheelers. They are Alison on the Narrowboat Mucker, Derek and Pauline Watts, Anna V, Sean James Cameron, Orange Cookie, Donna Kelly, Mary Keane, Tony Rutherford, Arabella Holtzapfel, Rory with MJ and Kayla, Narrowboat Precious Jet, Linda Reynolds-Birkins, Richard Noble, Carol Ferguson, Tracy Thomas, Mark and Tricia Stowe, and Madeline Smith. Thank you. I shall desire, and I shall find the best of my desires, the autumn road, the mellow wind that soothes the darkening shires, and laughter and in fires. White mist about the black hedge rose, the slumbering midland plain, the silence where the clover grows, and dead leaves in the lane, certainly these remain. It was with this extract from Rupert Brooke's poem The Chilterns that Tom Rolt begins his classic canal book, The Narrowboat. And as the year's turn rolls into deep autumn, I cannot think of a better way to start a book that is essentially about his experience of living in a boat on the canals. For of all the seasons, there's something about autumn that this kind of life welcomes and embraces. I don't let's misunderstand me. Spring, summer, and winter too all have their charms and their attractions. The special characteristics that form each season and to which life afloat provides a platform or a window from which to enjoy them. And challenges too. With each season, you come alive to a different aspect of living. Become aware of different rhythms, different sound worlds, different skyscapes, the slow revolution of the kaleidoscope, producing shifts in light and tones, different colours. And even the landscape changes its shape. The soft, flowing, flowering curves of summer hedgerow and tree shrink with the passing of the year, and become more angular, following more closely to the geological contours of field and skyline. If you took a time-lapse film over many years of the hedgeline just above us here, still rich red with hawberries and autumn, it would look as if the land was breathing, the rise and fall of foliage growth, the rhythm of life. But for me, there's something about autumn, and particularly the onset of autumn, that I find suits all the very best aspects of boat life most perfectly. Living on a boat seems to be made for the autumn. And as lovely as the long days of the warm summer months are, they are more suited for being outdoors, off the boat. The focus is of everything that's outside. And perhaps that's why those days in which that's not possible can feel sometimes frustrating or just plain wrong. However, with the onset of autumn, with its fading light and chill, the wash of rain like tonight, the accent is placed on life indoors. It's when the boat as home, rather than as boat, really comes into its own. For me, there's nothing to compare with that feeling of walking along the towpath as dusk deepens into night. The scent of mushroom and wet soil, and the hint of wood smoke in the air that is sharp with the bite of coming winter, and the rasp of night breezes among the reeds, a buttery moon playing among racing clouds. And if you are carrying a torch, and because of the large puddles at the moment you'd be wise to, the silver dart and shimmer of light, the flicks and skips across the canal's surface like a stone being skipped across a pond. And the air and the night wraps around you like a blanket, and your breath rises in white clouds of mist in front of you. You turn the corner under the large oak. An owl hoot, and there's a rustle among the rushes along the opposite bank. Moon shadows crisscross the muddy path as you splash through a waterlogged section. And there in front of you, tucked into the bank, behind a stand of reeds, lies a boat. Light spills out into the darkness, and a wreath of blue-grey smoke lazily curls upwards into the night. Surely there can be few sights more welcoming, or after shaking off your coat and boots, that enveloping feel of warmth as you climb the hatch steps down into the cabin and take your seat in the glow of firelight. I suppose it's that nesting instinct, the drawing in, the sense you get when you feel encircled, protected, safe. Of course, not every night is like this, and it's good that it's not. But there is a sense of being so close in proximity to the elements and part of the world just outside the cabin walls, and yet apart from it too. Autumn and some winter days, you get that feeling most of all. And with it comes that desire to slow down, step back, the time for reflection, to let thoughts flicker across the ceiling of your mind in the way that the firelight from the stove flickers across the cabin roof. I think I've always felt that way, but somehow being on a boat allows me the space to do that more freely and easily. And some nights, and particularly nights like these, when the sound of the wash of rain against the cabin walls There's nothing better than to just curl up beside the stove with a hot drink and a good book. And it seems to be exactly what autumn evenings are for. And so, taking our cue from Rupert Brooke and Tom Rolt, I think we'll spend this wet autumnal night with some poets who capture the season perfectly in this ruby and port glow of firelight. And I have here with me a little book that I found last year in a second-hand bookstore. It's called Forest and Vale and High Blue Hill, Poems of Gloucestershire, the Cotswolds and Beyond. And at the moment, we're moored on the very northwestern edge of the Cotswolds, and so it seems to be fairly apt choice for tonight. The book itself is just a little larger than my hand span, quite slim, but the pages are thick and creamy. It's accompanied by some beautiful black and white wood engravings by Ray Hedger, and comprises a collection of poems selected by folk musician Johnny Coppin, who apparently has set some of the selected poems here to music. It's published by a small Gloucestershire press, the Windrush Press. The Windrush is one of the rivers that lazily coils and loops its way through the Cotswolds. And on the first page of the book, there's an inscription in thick black ink. A Christmas Present from Alison, 1991. I think he would have made a very good Christmas present. I would have loved it anyway. I began with Rupert Brooke's poem, The Chilterns, a landscape that I know very well and love. But let's move a little northwest, a little bit closer to home here. This is David Ashby's Cotswolds. So much sky and light striking the stone and green uplands. Crow and cloud shadow drift and wheel, sheep and farms in the folds. Tumuli, spires, rutted tracks, relics of older ways, bones, fossils, quarries breaching the skin. And the wind, always. Nettles nod at stiles, orchards surprise where cattle graze, and on darkening slopes beeches stir and moan, splintering the sun. A land for the solitary, pungent in twilight, framed by mullion, lychgate, barn door, the silver river. Beyond. One of the features of the Cotswolds that I really love are the lanes, although nowadays increased traffic mean that they're often not so much fun to either drive or cycle or walk down now as they once were. But nevertheless, there's something peculiarly English about the way they twist and turn in an almost riverine flow. Between small fields, and then vaulting high onto the broad swells and skies of the wolds themselves. And all the time, passing through small villages and hamlets, built into the landscape, almost organic in look, of honey-coloured Cotswold stone. And I think Eva Dobell captures their feeling really beautifully in her poem, Cotswold roads. Those broad hill roads that lead the way, dusty and white with margins wide, of grass and myriad upland flowers, jeweled bands on either side. Great beds of trefoil golden bright and slender harebells clear and frail, scabious and milkwort pearly pure, rock roses primrose pale. The wild geranium's fragrant tide, massed clouds of each celestial hue, the very sky seems fallen there in drifts of azure blue. And still the broad white road leads on, to some grey village nestled deep in the hill's dimple where the elms seem centuries dropped asleep. A Cotswold village that has dozed for centuries thus grey and old, under the slope that breaks the wind that sweeps across the wold. The wind that sweeps across the wold where dried bents whiten to the sky, and like the voice of silence flits the lapwing's wheeling cry. And over hill and barren wold, where sun and fleet cloud shadows play, the white roads that the Romans trod still hold their ancient way. John Masefield, probably better known for his sea poems, particularly for Sea Fever, I Must Go Down to the Sea Again, the Lonely Sea and Sky, also seems to be drawn to the highways and the byways of the Cotswolds in his poem, Tewkesbury Road. It's good to be out on the road and going one knows not where, going through meadow and village one knows not whither nor why, through the grey light drift of the dust, in the keen cool rush of the air, under the flying white clouds and the broad blue lift of the sky, and to halt at the chattering brook, in the tall green fern at the brink, where the harebell grows and the gorse and the foxgloves purple and white, where the shy-eyed delicate deer troop down to the pools to drink, when the stars are mellow and large at the coming on of the night. Or to feel the warmth of the rain and the homely smell of the earth is a tune for the blood to jig to, a joy past power of words, and the blessed green comely meadows seem all a ripple with mirth and a lilt of the shifting feet and the dear, wild cry of the birds. And I love how the same rhythms and patterns of words that Masefield uses for his sea poems are found in this poem. And probably that's very apt, because there's something very oceanic almost about the geography and the geology of the Cotswolds, those great rolling waves of hills over which these roads follow. And this theme is continued again in the next poem, although now from a slightly different angle. It's the comparison between the little roads, the country lanes winding along through valleys and coombs, with the high roads, the main routes often clinging and contouring along the high ground, those old Roman roads, the old drovers' roads and pack horse routes, the ridgeways now municipalized into highways. And it also captures the romance of names of unknown or little-known places in the way it lists villages and hamlets. And by the way, the mention of Slaughter here refers to the valley in which the hamlets of Upper and Lower Slaughter are located. It's called The High Road by John Haines. The little roads are quaint roads that wander where they will. They wind their arms round all the farms and flirt with every hill. But the high road is my road and goes where I would go. Its way it wends as man intends, for it was fashioned so. The little roads are shy roads, and care not to be seen. Twixt hedges hid, they wind amid a labyrinth of green. But the high roads are bold roads, and stare one in the face. With banners white in all men's sight, the land they proudly pace. The little roads are faint roads, and fear to walk alone. They like the looks of friendly brooks, and cots of county stone. But the high roads are proud roads, and lord it like the king. They stride the dale, the hills to scale, o'er wasting rivers they prevail, nor yield to anything. To all the little roads I know, delightful haunts belong. In hidden state lurk Stanway Gate and Stanway Woods among. The river walk among the colnes from Fossway lies apart, while Slaughter seems amid its streams to dwell in willow-patterned dreams, dreamt by a childish heart. But give me on the autumn day that lordly road to trace, from Charlton Hill to Bornton Mill and sister marketplace. Or back the way that Romans came above a folded world, to Birdlip's Deep, where in a leap the road doth to the valley sweep, where Severn lies unfurled. The little roads are warm roads, and find a house within. They grow great trees, escape the breeze, and nurse the homely inn. The high roads are dry roads for many a thirsty mile, but their wind and rain thou wilt face again, as I have done many a while. And although this is not particularly autumnal, the character of the Cotswolds is rendered in the next poem, or an extract from the poem, so beautifully. The wolds are the high ground. The valleys that cut through it are riverine, and the Windrush is one of those rivers. And another is the Evenlode, possibly my favourite of all names for a river, almost Tolkien-esque. And this is Hillaire Belloc, and it's an extract from his poem, Dedicatory Ode. The quiet evening kept her tryst. Beneath an open sky we rode, and passed into a wandering mist along the perfect Evenlode. The tender Evenlode that makes a meadow hush to hear the sound of waters mingling in the brakes and binds my heart to English ground. A lovely river, all alone she lingers in the hills and holds 100 little towns of stone, forgotten in the western wolds. One of the characteristic features of particularly the high ground, the wolds, is their walls. As with further north, the fields in this area are demarcated by dry stone walls that cling precipitously to the skyline, forming long, straggling lines, often mile upon mile, across the smooth belly and folds of this land. Decorated by the emeralds of moss and golds of lichen, they stand testimony to passing time and have about them an air of antiquity. Although of human construction, like many of the canals, long ago they have joined and become one with the land and with the elements. And I love this poem by Brian Waters, This Ancient Wall. This ancient wall of Cotswold stone has listened low to every storm, whose murmurs through her crevices sang softly to the mighty trees she sheltered once in infant form. From youth she saw these monarchs grow to giants, whose deep serenade cast about her honoured bones their wealth of cooling shade. Beside these trees and moss-grown stones, a weary traveller loved to rest, and was the wall's appointed guest. Last night the tempest swept the wold, and racked the trees whose music smote a sound so old yet strangely new, out of each muscle, bone and thew, into the war's deep throat. She felt their roots beneath her feet, quiver and creak like beasts afraid, who cower under storms of sleet when thunder loosens lightning's blade. Five trunks of wood on scattered stone, five breaches in a ruined wall, bear witness of the muffled groan she uttered at these loved ones' fall. In landscapes such as this, it's hard not to become sensitive to cycles of time beyond our own, to be aware of other lives, past lives, whose influence can be still felt. In places like this, time slows its pace and even becomes transparent. It's a landscape inhabited by ghosts, though not necessarily in the scary sense. This next poem reflects this theme. Autumn's Halloween, but also the custom of sharing ghost stories around the fire, makes this a particularly appropriate poem for tonight. And it's John Drinkwater's The Cotswold Farmers. Sometimes the ghosts forgotten go along the hilltop way, and with long scythes of silver mow meadows of moonlit hay, until the cocks of Cotswold crow the coming of the day. There's Tony Turkletob, who died when he could drink no more, and Uncle Heritage, the pride of 1824, and Ebenezer Barleytide, and others half a score. They fold in phantom pens and plough furrows without a share, and one will milk a fairy cow, and one will stare and stare, and whistle ghostly tunes that now are not sung anywhere. The moon goes down on Oak Ridge Lee, and other worlds astir. The Cotswold farmers silently go back to sepulchre, and sleeping watchdogs wait and see no ghostly harvester. I'd like to finish tonight the way I began, by reading from Tom Rolt's book, Narrowboat. I said when I began that for me, the autumn brings together everything that I love about life afloat in a narrowboat. And I think Tom Rolt would agree. As beautiful as his descriptions of his journeying throughout the year are, his writing certainly moves up a gear when he comes to describing autumn. And so I will leave you with this extract, which relates his time on the Shropshire Canal. He had just ascended the Audlem flight. At the summit of the flight, we crossed the border of Shropshire and found rolling wooded country between this point and the next five locks at Adderley, a welcome change after the monotony of the Cheshire levels. By this time, the westerly breeze had freshened considerably, and a rack of swift-chasing clouds was sweeping like smoke out of Wales. We had climbed to the last of the five locks when a cold rain began to fall, so we lost no time in tying up, and were soon settling down to tea in the welcome warmth of the sitting cabin, eating hot buttered chorley cakes in the flickering firelight while the rain beat against the windows and pattered on the deck above. We were discovering that canal cruising aboard Cressy did not depend for its fascination upon summer weather. Bare branches dark against a winter sky, and a flight of rooks beating homeward, wind tossed like charred scraps of paper, the rich bloom of new ploughland, great honey-coloured ricks new thatched, and the stillness of sky-reflecting pools. Such pictures can convey but little of rewards as great as any that summer had brought us. It was a new and unfailing delight, a after standing for hours at the tiller in the keen air, rich with the scents of late autumn, to moor in some lonely place. Close the hatches and retreat to the sitting cabin. An island of warmth and comfort in the gathering dark, where familiar objects, the many-coloured bindings of beloved books, the gleaming copper kettle and outspread tea-things, awoke to new and gracious life in the lamplight. To lie in bed of a night, or in the drowsy warmth of a hot bath, and listen to the wind rushing overhead, was to be reminded of Francis Cornford's poem, The Country Bedroom. My room's a square and candle-lighted boat, in the surrounding depths of night afloat. My windows are the portholes, and the sea's the sound of rain in the dark apple trees. And when curtains are drawn, it was often hard to believe that our room really was a square and candle-lighted boat, whose windows looked out each night upon a strange darkness. This is the Narrowboat Erica, signing off for the night and wishing you a very restful and peaceful night. Good night. Temperature, outside, 4.8 degrees. Inside, 22 degrees. Humidity, 93%. Dew point, 4 degrees. Wind direction, south-southwest. Wind strength, 8 miles per hour. Barometric pressure, 969.9 falling. Cloud cover, 90%. Cloud ceiling, 1,500 feet. Precipitation, 2.03 millimeters. Moon phase, 63.4%, waning gibbous. Day length, 9 hours 29 minutes. Sunset, 16:35. Sky casting, 7:08.